Hi, everybody. I'm Steph Wissink, Managing Director in Consumer Research at Jefferies.
And I am Gerrick Johnson, Equity Research Analyst at BMO Capital Markets. And we're going to talk all about toys and a lot of different topics that pertain to toys. So, Steph, do you want to start us off with one of our topics?
Yeah, I think so. The spirit of this is Mary reached out to us to have a conversation around some of the things that we've learned over the course of the last few months coming off of the year-end reports from some of the public companies, but also what would have normally been a cycle of trade fairs. Gerrick and I usually get to see each other at Toy Fair every year, so we missed out on that, but happy to share and compare some notes on what we found to be some of the themes. So one of the things that has been top of mind for me is just thinking through on the backside of COVID, what are some of the things, the trends that we think are going to be somewhat more permanent, sticking around. And I think one of the things that really strikes me about 2020 is that there does seem to be a real authentic reconnection to classic play patterns in the toy category, including games. And I think that's one thing, at least as a parent and certainly as an analyst, observing some real strength in that category. And it does seem to be a category that consistently has shown some strength. So I would expect that that's something that probably sticks around as we move forward over the next couple of years. Maybe it doesn't grow as fast, but I think families are connecting around a board game at the dining room table, and that's something that has certainly brought joy back and connection back to the family. So I'm expecting that that sticks around. Gerrick, how about you?
Yeah, I think you're right there, Steph. You know, classic brands did well this past year. I think, you know, we're still in this for a little while, and who knows when we emerge from our cocoons, but the shift to e-com and things like that, people think of the classic multi-generational brands, I think. I do think it's going to be hard for new brands and new innovation to emerge. You know, we're not walking the stores, and rest in peace Toys R Us. You know, we're not seeing, you know, 10 different varieties of one product concept. So it'll be hard for some of those new innovations and new brands to stick out. And I think the classics are going to continue to do well for a while. Connection as a family has been big, and I think that will continue. So I think you're definitely on the right track there, Steph.
What about e-com? Yeah, I think it was one of the surprises, just, you know, looking back in hindsight, even listening to companies like Walmart and Target talk about their omni-channel initiatives, click and collect, curbside pickup. I mean, I think the numbers, frankly, from Target are quite staggering. But I know it's a question we're getting asked a lot from investors, just what does that mean in terms of inventory levels, where inventory is located? The stores seem to be acting more and more as distribution centers, maybe less as transactional centers. What are you hearing on that side?
Yeah, no, similarly, I did my first click and collect last fall, and I was amazed at how much I liked it. You know, your instant gratification, that worked out very well. I think that's going to continue. So what they say is trends that were in motion have accelerated with this pandemic. So that was one that was occurring and has accelerated. The downside of e-com, though, is you lose out on impulse. You're not walking through the store. You're not seeing something that catches your eye and say, hey, wait a minute, he or she will really like that. Let's get that. You know, when you go on your web page, you pretty much have a list of what you're gonna get. And on my list, it would probably be for my four-year-old about to turn five. It would be Jurassic World dinosaurs and Gujitsus from Moose Toys. And that's what we'd be searching for. And I'm not sure if I'd be seeing a whole lot of other products when I put those products in the Amazon or Walmart search engine. So that's probably the biggest downside. And again, not seeing other products catch your eye that might have some new innovation or might be different from the things you're already using and playing with.
Yeah, so, Gerrick, you actually bring up a really good point on e-commerce. Yeah, the one of the pitfalls might be that the search function drives an increased level of algorithmic choice. And so you're being fed more things that are aligned with your algorithm. So the bell curve gets centralized and some of the tails get stubbed short. And Even just listening to some of the companies as they've reported, you know, that to your point, the higher price points seem to perform well. The impulse price points were a little bit more challenged, but the bigger brands got bigger. And so as an industry, you know, that's one of the things I love about the toy industry is that there's always space in the tails for new brands to emerge. Something definitely we're probably going to have to watch as we kind of analyze the industry over the next few years, just what's the permanence of that effect?
Yeah. And, you know, look, it's going to be, without the trade shows, it's going to be harder for the little guys to emerge. You know, the big guys go visit each other, right? Either the retailers are going to El Segundo or Pawtucket or the manufacturers are going to Bentonville or Minneapolis or Seattle. So they're seeing each other, but it's harder for the little guys to stand out. So that's my gripe with e-com. I'm old school. I was a Child World guy, actually, competitor to Toys R Us way back when. And nothing beat the experience of going into that store and just going, wow, look at all this stuff. And, you know, kids haven't had that chance or that opportunity this year because moms have been deciding, hey, we're not going to bring you along into the store when we go to the store, or we're going to do our shopping online. So how are things being discovered? That's probably a good topic we could talk about next. How are things being discovered? What is the role of influencers? What is the role of marketing, and how do we market to kids who are cocooning still? And again, hopefully we're emerging at some point, but right now, gosh, Oliver, my 4-year-old, has been into dinosaurs for so damn long. I'm just so tired of dinosaurs. But that's all he's into because that's all he's seeing. He's watching Bluey on TV, but, you know, this is another topic we can talk about, streaming and entertainment. But he's just watching Bluey, 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 Bluey. That's all he's watching. And he can watch it whenever he wants, all the time. And he's not really discovering anything else. So what do you think about marketing to kids and getting kids to experience new toys and discover new toys these days?
Yeah, I think you raise a really good point. And I think even to the extent that maybe the back half of 21 looks a little different, if kids do get invited to go back to the store with mom or dad, you know, are the retailers ready to provide an experience that does delight and that does really drive that impulse and that discovery? I think we've seen some advancements in merchandising, but to your point, you know, with the absence of Toys R Us, there isn't that emporium effect anymore, that just overall playground effect. So I'm looking forward to some of the brands, you know, really taking some risk and creating immersive experiences at retail and working with retail partners to try to bring some life back and energy back. So it's not just a purchase. It actually is play and discovery alongside a purchase. And it's hard to do that in digital. I don't think kids are engaging in those digital models like we maybe are seeing from the adults. So it's a good question. Let's jump over to entertainment because you brought that up, you know, streaming, just different platforms of entertainment. Certainly something I'm sure you're getting asked about, I'm getting asked a lot about too, but just the overall trend line of some of this entertainment coming back to market this year.
Yeah, you know, it segues perfectly because we know from the analyst days we've attended recently that the toy companies are leaning heavily into entertainment, their own entertainment, creating their own entertainment, either internally or using partners, and that's the new way, I guess, of getting the attention of the kids, getting them to buy those consumer products through entertainment. But look, paradigms are shifting, and I don't know the answer. Maybe you might know the answer better than I do right now. But paradigms are shifting. They haven't settled yet. We don't know. I think the hybrid that we're seeing now of movies in theater and streaming concurrently, I don't know what happens with that, if that creates more toy sales or fewer. Do people forego the big experience of being in the theater and everyone doing it kind of at the same time? Or, you know, if it comes out on streaming, being like, yeah, well, I can watch that next week or what. So there are, what's coming next, Steph, that we have to watch out for in the theaters or on streaming?
Yeah, I'm with you. I think this is an unresolved point of what feels like somewhat of a tension, but certainly is an opportunity as well. I think we're thinking about it almost in different classes and genres. So I would expect that the theaters are still the best place to see a big action film. And that big action, has an audience that extends from a young child up through a collector and an adult. And good entertainment is still going to sell well in the theaters. But I also concur with the notion of streaming access to the home. And what we do know is that a lot of toy purchasing is tied to the repeat watching of content. So you're getting an earlier ability to press the replay button over and over and over again. And so I'm curious to see if that creates a different life cycle for brands at retail that are tied to entertainment. And then clearly we have a case study from 2020 like Mandalorian, which has taken what was a bit more of an episodic property and really made it more of an evergreen property. And I think others are probably looking at that. Not every brand is going to qualify for that kind of cadence, but I would sure imagine that some of the entertainment companies are looking at that as a proxy for how to think about some of their brands becoming more evergreen brands.
Well, look, we have Raya and the Last Dragon coming soon, and that will be very interesting to see how, that's not necessarily the biggest tentpole that we would have thought about, but it is kind of the first one to come out in 2021 with that real hybrid, we're going to do at the same time approach that actually has a toy line tied to it. So we'll see how that goes. Look, My Little Pony is going right straight to Netflix, but then we've got Paw Patrol still theaters only. We'll see. That's later on August and September for those two. Mm-hmm. We'll see how that works out. But, I don't know. It's so I know I've talked to some executives who think that the hybrid launching both concurrently is going to generate more toy sales. Again, I have no idea. There's just so much uncertainty. A lot of these questions we're asking ourselves, the simple answer could be, I don't know. But it's fun to postulate and think about what could be. My guess is I think we sell more toys if we're more oriented towards the big theatrical event and experience. And again, maybe I'm old school. I'm an old Star Wars kid, right? So what do you think, Steph?
Yeah, I think there's something to still be said around creating a universal marketing approach, and the theater provides a lot of buzz. The box office numbers, the headlines, the word of mouth excitement, and then at the same time recognizing we're on the backside of a pretty strong economic shock, and the family is very value focused, and so you can subscribe to Disney Plus for the cost of taking your family to a movie. So it's, I do think there's going to be some lessons learned as we kind of observe how 2021 plays out as a transition year. I don't know that we're going to be able to answer the question in full with any degree of resolution until we get out a couple of years and just see how things shake out and settle out. And but I do agree with you. I think there's nothing more magical than seeing a movie in a theater, and there's nothing more exciting than the buzz that it creates across not only toys, but certainly licensing as well.
Yeah, the popcorn, the Twizzlers, things like that. I'll tell you one thing that I've noticed. I keep mentioning my 4-year-old, Oliver. Prior to him being born, I always took pride in being a toy. And I was like saying that, I'm not influenced because I don't have any kids, so I'm an objective observer. But it has been fascinating, watching what he does as he grows up. And since the pandemic hit, what we've been doing is he's on a pretty regular routine. He is going to preschool every day, full time. He gets back, he plays a little bit. Around 4, maybe, he takes a bath. And after bath time, he always watches a movie on Disney Plus. Every single day, a movie on Disney Plus. Now, I was saying he watches Bluey all the time. In his free time, when he's eating breakfast, he watches Bluey and those episodes. But about 4:30, 5 o'clock, he watches a movie. And 90% of the time, it's something on Disney Plus. Once in a while, it's something off Netflix or Amazon Prime. But every single day. Now, as things change and we emerge from this cocoon, like I said, will he keep doing that? Probably. He's in that schedule and that routine. And every every day. We're going to give him a bath at 4, and at 4:30 he's going to say, where's my movie? Even if we're doing other things. So it'll be interesting. My point there is, those changes and those shifts that we've experienced while we've been in this cocoon for the last year, almost year plus, some of those will endure. And he's been consuming a lot more content than he would have otherwise. But I do have a feeling that at some point we're going to be like, get out of the house and go play with your friends, which we don't do right now. We say, don't play with your friends, watch a movie.
Yeah, I concur with that. I think that's exactly right. And my kids are a little older. I've got a middle schooler and a kind of later elementary third grader. But I do think, Mary had asked us too to think a little bit about some of the psychological impacts on consumer and the kids in particular. I think what you're talking about is we've established new routines, and those routines are becoming somewhat ingrained. And there's going to be a process of grieving the loss of those routines and introducing new routines. And I do think there's going to be a hangover effect that probably takes a couple of years to reestablish some of those social connections. And for kids in particular, toys can sometimes be that bridge. And so I think the industry, has a role in reconnecting kids, particularly in some of those social play categories. So I'm looking forward to that too. That is one of the things that I had hoped to spend some time looking for at Toy Fair this year. It's just, how is the industry going to take on the responsibility of reconnecting friends in the core kid range? And I would say I see that with my kids. They're very much connected digitally. They're playing the digital games with their friends, even when they're sitting in the same room. But there's a physicality element too that I think will start to come back to life when we feel comfortable socially starting to reconnect.
Yeah. We're going tangentially here, but video games have filled a huge void. Video games have had the best year ever, just like a lot of other digital enterprises. But look, it's not just about playing games anymore. As Ronan Harary said the other day on the Spin Master call, it's live services. You're constantly changing these games over time, dropping more content, keeping them engaged. But at the same time, the social connection that kids have through these games, through playing Fortnite together, through playing Call of Duty, through playing Toca Boca, Words with Friends, there is that connection that's happening. It's digitally. It had been happening before for sure, and people were making new friends in far off lands as they sat on their couch playing Call of Duty. But I think the video game industry has taken on sort of that role of keeping those connections while kids can't see each other physically. Maybe you see with your kids, there's more of an acceptance by parents to say, okay, fine, play more video games. Usually it's you get a half hour screen time and get off, and now they're being a little bit more lax, and you're seeing kids connect with other kids that way.
I would agree. Yeah. And I think, one of the topics that we were watching closely too is parents have never been more integrated into their children's learning than what we saw in 2020. And just thinking about the play pattern of video games, I think even in the educational space and the educational play space, the gamification of learning is becoming a reality. So even seeing what my kids were engaged with and just this notion of a very consistent logic to gaming, video gaming, in the way that they're learning. Some of these online modules are very much inspired by games. So I think that's interesting that it's almost like we're creating a completely new fluency, a new language among a generation of users in this idea of gamification, and how that could manifest as an opportunity for the industry, I think is certainly an area to watch.
Yes, the acceptance of digital. So let me ask you, Steph, your kids being a little older, were they going to school full time? Were they learning from home remotely over the computer or the iPad? So how was their education experience over the last year, I guess?
Yeah, a year essentially. So last March we went down and went dark for the balance of the school year, and then they were in a digital model all the way through just until about a month ago. And my daughter, actually in middle school, sixth grade, is still in a hybrid model. So in school 2 days a week and at home 3 days a week. My little guy now is back in school all 5 days a week. But I will say it was really interesting being a part of that experience because, you know, number one, you become very aware of the pace of their learning versus just at conferences. You get to see what they're expected to achieve each day, but also having to come up with creative ways to make learning fun. And I'm clearly not an educator. So hats off to all the teachers because, you know, we found ourselves having to get very, very creative. I'll just give you one example. My daughter is learning currently about lunar and solar eclipses. And so we had out on a piece of white paper, a grapefruit, a mandarin, and a grape to line up the sun, the earth, and the moon. And we are coming up with crazy experiments. And in some cases using Play-Doh and toys. And so I do think it's been an interesting experience as a parent to be connected to the learning journey of your child in that way. And also just recognizing that they are spending a disproportionate amount of time in front of screens as we do for work, but they're almost being expected to be in front of a screen just like we are. And so after the end of a day, I can tell that they're fatigued. They're tired from that screen experience. And so when my little guy went back, boy, we've got a different kid in the house. Much more balanced, much calmer. Feels like he's getting back into his groove.
Oh, yeah, yeah. My little guy, when he was not going to school, turned into a monster. And I often had to separate him and his mom, or else we'd have Battle Royale. But he's become, you know, back to that sweet kid he is. But, you know, going back to school is great, you know, from the toy industry perspective, you know, pun intended, that's where trends kind of propagate virally.
Yeah.
You know, kids show off their toys and... But look, my guy's going to school and he's not allowed to bring toys to school. I don't think you're ever allowed to bring toys to school, but you know, now you're really not allowed to bring toys to school, but at least they're, you know, I'm sure some are smuggled in, and I'm sure there's some Bakugan or some Beyblades or maybe even a chess set or two out there, in the schoolyard. So that's really good, a good thing for the toy industry to get, those trends going. And kids experiencing toys with other kids, you know, as opposed to just playing by themselves or playing with their parents at home.
I agree. I think that's, and I'm curious to see how that manifests, you know, this year in some of the sales trends. You know, a lot of the play activities we saw last year, with the exception of board games, were very individualized play. Some of the social play categories were hit, certainly as well as preschool, just with the lack of family gatherings and gifting events. So I would expect those categories to start to normalize a bit more as we get through the course of this year.
Yeah, I agree. I agree. And that's really good. Hey, we were talking about something earlier that I don't think we were talking about on this recording, but the impact of the pandemic on birth rates is something interesting that we were talking about, and we were mentioning that there's been some data coming out for the month of December, which is nine months after March, when we all got locked down, and birth rates have been plummeting. Not to say that that's going to continue in January and February, because March was the onset, and we'll see, you know, every 9 months as we go forward what it looks like. But so far, it's looking like birth rates are down rather significantly. And look, they have been since 2008. And that has an impact on the toy industry for sure. So what do you think, Steph? Do you think we're going to see the preschool category get hit in a year or two with declining birth rates? Or what's your view on that?
Yeah, I think it's something we definitely are mindful of. I mean, certainly even seeing it first in some of the infant categories. You know, I think that's where it will show up. And then it has a bit of a bubble effect as it kind of works its way through the system. So yeah, I would agree with you. I think it actually countered the initial logic to see these rate numbers coming in so light. I think the expectation was, and we facetiously would say, you know, bow chicka wow wow, it was going to be a great year for births. But actually all we got of that was the bow wow part. I mean, pet industry adoption has been up double digits. So you know, if we are seeing the establishment of new households, millennial, and you know, in some cases maybe even getting into some of the Gen Z category now, households, you know, they're deferring those family starts, and maybe they're starting with a pet. And I'm curious to see kind of how the suburbanization trend in combination with pet ownership and deferred births, how that gets digested through the traditional toy category over the course of the next couple of years, because it could be a bit of a headwind for some of the younger cohort categories.
But at the same time, you brought up something very interesting, the suburbanization. I moved out of Manhattan very serendipitously, actually, in August of 19, basically because I wanted my son to have a yard and a driveway and shoot hoops and nowhere he's going to school. There was some confusion in New York City as exactly where kids were going to be going to school. But nevertheless, we have seen so many families from the Upper West Side move into our town. These schools are going to be so crowded as they roll through. But all these kids that would have grown up, you know, from my experience being a former Manhattanite, from growing up in an apartment building on the Upper West Side to now growing up in a suburbs with a yard and a driveway, maybe that's good for the toy industry. I don't know, but it's definitely something that we're seeing big time where I live.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think, you know, it calls on different categories within the industry. Maybe some of those crossover categories in terms of sporting goods, things like outdoor trampolines and skates and skateboards and outdoor
blasters.
Blasters, yeah. Absolutely. So I think there's an element of suburbanization that means backyard play and outdoor play. Those could be categories. I know we saw some benefit of that last summer. I think to your point, just getting kids out of the house, away from screens, doing something different. But that might be a bit more of a permanent effect tied to the suburbanization trend. And then in the households, they're really being kind of this next bubble now with millennials establishing new households.
Yeah. Yeah. So we've probably got time for maybe one or two more topics. We're going to go a half hour here, and we're approaching that. Is there anything that in the last few minutes you want to talk about, Steph?
Well, you know, I think one of the things that we're getting asked a lot from an investment perspective is just the conversation around ESG is really starting to evolve. And I know many of the toy companies have now come out with their commitments around packaging, around waste, around plastic use. And I think that certainly ties to some of the consumer insight work, that consumers are just far more conscious about the brands that they're buying. Sure. And what they expect of those brands in terms of minimizing the impact on the environment. And also, and I think this is probably something that has shown up a bit more in how brands are marketing and coming to market, is really representing brands in a more inclusive way. And, you know, Barbie is probably the best case study for this, but really opening up the brands to be about inclusivity and about empowerment and reducing some of the historic gender stereotypes that have existed in the industry. I'm actually frankly surprised that some of the companies still classify their segments based on girls and boys. I think that's something we could see change over the course of the next few years, because the industry has started to move away from gender stereotypes and towards more of an inclusive posture. And that can even turn up in marketing and content. I think you're going to see the change in content as well, and just showcasing the diversity of where you live and the different types of experiences that different family structures have. And I think that's really encouraging. As a parent, I'm incredibly encouraged by it. But I think, you know, the industry could certainly be taking some steps forward here over the course of the next several years to really be a leader within consumer goods around things like inclusivity, environmental impact, corporate social responsibility, you know, diversity on boards and leadership teams. So thus far, I've been really encouraged. And but I think there's, you know, plenty of work to do. And certainly as an industry that is inspiring the next generation, I think there's a responsibility as well.
Yeah, no, I agree. I've seen that a lot, and the consumer's really driving that, right? The government didn't have to say, hey, reduce your packaging, get rid of plastic. It's the consumer that's wanted it. So that's really encouraging that we're seeing that. It's the consumer that's wanted diversity and inclusivity and those themes that we're seeing. So the consumer's driving that, and what the consumer wants, we'll give them, and we're giving them the ESG that they want. Mm-hmm. I'm going to disagree with you on one thing, though, Steph. Boys toys, girls toys. they do play differently. And I go back to when Lego launched the Friends line, And it was fascinating research that they presented at a PlayCon once. And I think it was Mike Moynihan who said that girls, when they have a Lego play set, play on the inside, and boys play on the outside. And I always thought about that, and it's right. You know, boys will have, you know, the knights battling the dragon outside the castle, and the girls will have the figures, you know, playing together, you know, tea party, what have you. I don't know. I look at it from the boys' side, but playing on the inside. So there are differences in how boys and girls play. But to all your other points, I totally agree. And, you know, we'll see if the consumer wants, gender neutral or wants boys' toys and girls' toys, mm-hmm. yet to be determined.
Yeah, I think even celebrating those differences is an opportunity. Clearly, there are certain classes of goods where you're going to see a more gender skewed user base, player base. But even, you know, embracing that difference then, and to your point with Lego, I think that's a great example of identifying an insight and really embracing it and making the play experience that much better because of that celebration of that difference.
Right. It's kind of a subtle thing, right? Yeah. Boys play on the outside, boys combat, girls cooperating, and boys battle. So, there are differences. But anyway, I think we're running out of time here, so I hope everyone got a little bit of insight and found this useful. I enjoyed our last half hour, Steph, so
likewise.
We'll do it again.
Sounds good. Thank you. We'll talk more soon, everyone.
All right. Thanks, everybody. Take care. Good night.